How do we regenerate our soils on our pastures and fields in a small scale on our farms? I'm Rob from Dowdle Family Farms, and when I moved back to the farm 5 years ago, I really wanted to start integrating cover crops into some of the farming areas. The problem that I ran into, though, and the question that I struggled with, is I knew that cover crops were important. I also knew that everybody touts the importance of no-till drilling and not using herbicides or fungicides and all this other stuff. And how does all that fit together on a small scale when you have limited equipment, limited resources, limited time, especially because you're a part-time farmer? I have used these same principles on other areas of the farm, and it's amazing how quickly you can get results in just a year or two that are absolutely tremendous. However, this is my more ambitious project to date. So this video is really the series introduction that explains how we're doing this on the 10-acre field that you see behind me. And one of the things that I think is going to be most critical in this series is that as different things change, as weather and patterns change and available resources change, the plans have to adapt as well. And there are sometimes there are great successes, and then other times things don't work out the way you want to. In fact, sometimes they're just downright failures. But I want to help chronicle this so that you can see how this is occurring on our farm, but also how you can do it as well. Let's begin by defining regenerative agriculture. Now, I'm going to be honest with you, I don't know what other people consider regenerative agriculture. Some people think of it as just organic farming. Some people say all farming is in itself regenerative. So I'm going to define regenerative agriculture for myself and what are kind of my guiding principles. A large part of that is because when I think of regenerative agriculture, I think of an entire ecosystem that's on our farm, but also in the areas and the neighborhoods and the communities around us. I try to operate by five basic principles of soil health that really begin my journey to regenerative agriculture. The first is we always try to have soil armor. In other words, we want something on the soil to help keep in moisture, to help maintain temperatures, and to help feed the soil microbes. That could be everything from mulches like mulched hay, leaves, compost. A soil armor might also be a plant that's actually growing or at least covering the soil at all times during the year. So the second principle of soil health is minimal soil disturbance. Most of the time when we think of soil disturbance, we think of things like deep tillage, but also the impact that animals make. One of the problems with major soil disturbance is like deep tillage especially, is that it can kill earthworms. Earthworms do a world of a lot of good in terms of turning over the soil. There's a book about that that I read that's really, really fascinating. But deep tillage can also destroy the environments for the mycorrhizal fungi and other soil life. There's a whole host of soil life within the soil, and what it does is it helps break down organic matter. So to combat the problems with deep tillage, what happens is farmers tend to use no-till drills. The problem with the no-till drills, however, is that they tend to be very expensive. If you can rent them, it takes a while to go pick them up. A lot of times they're not in great shape, so you have to repair them or get somebody to help you repair them. Then you have to calibrate them and to learn how to use that specific machine and then take the machine back. I'm telling you, I've rented no-till drills 3 different times, and it is just an absolute pain, and it never quite worked out the way that I expected it to. So later in this video, I'll show you how we work around that minimal soil disturbance and how we succeed and how we fail with that. The third principle of soil health is always having a living root. And the reason that this is so important is because the soil life needs some kind of feed to continue to live throughout the year. Well, when you have plants in the soil, they release these exudates into the soil that feed the soil life. As the soil life grows and dies, they in turn provide a lot of nutrients that the plants cannot get on their own. So there's this symbiotic relationship. I hope that's the right word. Let me know if it's not. I don't have a thesaurus with me out here at the farm. But what happens is the roots of the plant and the soil life work together so that they both get what they need to thrive. And so therefore, we don't have to include a lot of fertilizers. We actually do not use any commercial fertilizers, even organic fertilizers anymore. We just don't need to. We'd prefer to take things a little bit slowly and a little bit more naturally. But always having a living root helps feed that soil life. Even when it's dry, having a living root in the soil can help protect the soil. And also when you do get a little bit of rain, those plants can jumpstart and growth. So the fourth principle of soil health that I'll mention is the integration of livestock. As you can see, we have pigs. Well, it looks like they're mostly taking naps now, but we have pigs that work on the farm. We also have cows. Not only do they provide an income for the farm, but their manure, rather than being a hazardous material in a feedlot, is broadcast and scattered more naturally and more evenly over the farm. And in that process, their manure helps improve the soils as well. But livestock integration somehow helps soil health as well. So the fifth and final principle of soil health that I'll mention is a diversity of species. With the diversity of plants in our pastures, we've seen a lot of benefit, especially at our Redfield. But we have dandelion growing, we have legumes like white clover growing that help provide nitrogen. Dandelion has a deep tap root, and so it'll bring up minerals from deeper in the soil profile that the pigs and the cows will eat. So does dock and plantain and chicory. The legumes add protein to the diet of the livestock, and the legumes will also add nitrogen to help feed the soil life and help the other plants around them grow better too. For us, when we're planting our cover crops, I started off planting just a single sorghum sedan grass cover crop, and it did really, really well on its own. But I've noticed a world of a lot more difference as I've added more species to our cover crop mix. By including other species in our cover crop mix, we don't get quite as much production, but we see a lot more diverse different types of insects, beneficial insects. So in addition to that sorghum sedan grass cover crop, we'll include cowpeas, we'll include soybeans, sunflowers, okra, buckwheat, a couple types of brassicas, all different types of plants because they have different types of roots and they accomplish different purposes. For example, one of my favorite things is to grow a crop of buckwheat early in the spring or especially late in the fall if we can have enough soil moisture. Buckwheat roots are only 8 to 10 inches deep or so from what I've noticed, but one thing that buckwheat does is it makes phosphorus much more available. It'll both scavenger phosphorus, but it also produces a mild acid with its root exudate that help break down the minerals in the soil. And that phosphorus that's in the soil, but it's not plant available, will become much more plant available. Buckwheat also, within 60 days, can form a grain head that can be harvested by pigs. So I like that aspect of buckwheat as well. So different roots and different plants produce different results in a diverse cover crop mix. Over the course of a whole year, we try to include 15 to 20 to even 30 different cover crops in our pastures if we can. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. It also depends on what we have available when we're trying to plant the crops as well. So these five principles of soil health work really, really well, especially when they work together. The other thing that I really like about this system as well, in addition to not needing any fertilizers, we also begin growing much more of the feed for our livestock. Now, we grass finish our cattle, and the sorghum sedan grass cover crop is outstanding to help grass finish cattle. But for pigs, they can't eat on just a fescue pasture. They can't survive on just grass alone. If they have good quality pasture that includes some legumes and brassicas, they can survive, but just feeding them grass like fescue would be just like feeding you or me fescue. They just don't perform. It doesn't have the nutrients that they need. They don't have the stomachs that ruminants like cows do. And by reducing the amount of feed that I have to purchase from our local feed store, that feed is produced in monoculture agriculture. Even though we may need some monoculture agriculture, if I can reduce my reliance on monoculture agriculture, for me, that's as much about regenerative farming, because more of the livestock feed is grown in one place. It doesn't have to be hauled, it doesn't have to be milled, it doesn't even have to be harvested by me. rather the pigs harvest it as well. So those are some of the more attractive parts of regenerative agriculture for me. Now let me show you a little bit about this field, where it is now, and then we'll talk about the strategies moving forward. Right there to where the gate is to the right there, you'll see that that's a gate into what I call field B. And then field A is right there on the left. You can see that it is, there's a single wire right there that keeps cows out. We got to put up a pig fence before I can start using it. In one video that I published early part of January of 2023, I talked about how my plan had been to put hay out in this field and to feed cows in it. There were several issues with that. We have to figure out what to do next. Paddock B, though, is divided into a northern half and a southern half. In the northern half, I planted soybeans last August 1st. They grew really well and then had some problems with them. I've got two videos on that. Now, in the southern half, it's divided into three different paddocks with polywire. Now, I put pigs in the first paddock about 8 weeks ago. I moved them 4 weeks ago, and then as I moved them, I overseeded it. So the pigs will go off of this field. We'll put them in the woods somewhere out of the way, and hopefully we'll begin feeding pigs in this 10-acre field again with the crops that we're growing in another 6 weeks or so. Now this 10-acre field is only a small portion of the pasture on the farm. So this 10 acres is part of about 40 acres that my dad had cleared for pasture several years ago. He had it planted with fescue. He also put out several tons of lime per acre over the course of a few years. He reseeded it a second time with fescue and clover mix. The problem with this 10 acre field is that most of the grasses that grow out here, the cattle do not perform very well on. So that's why we're trying to regenerate this area. And then in a few years, maybe probably overseeding this area of the farm with more quality permanent pastures after the soil life has improved much greater. So the paddock that you see behind me, it's the southern end of field B, and it's the second paddock that we grazed. The biggest challenge for small farmers is how do you plant and how do you terminate or harvest your cover crops without the heavy machinery or the specialized machinery that you need. For me, what I did is I just used the pigs in this paddock to root it up and to tear it up. I left them in there about 4 weeks. Typically, I prefer to move the pigs every 2 weeks. I left them in there longer so that they would disturb the soil more so that I could plant. Frankly, if I had not used the pigs for such a long period of time, I would not have been able to plant this for several more weeks until it dries out. So by using the pigs to in there a little bit longer, allowed me to go on and plant my cover crops sooner. They're cover crops that the pigs will eat, that they'll thrive on. There's no way that I could have planted this with a tiller, with a disc, or with a no-till drill. It's just way too wet. There are times where we may have to use a disc or a tiller to plant the seed. The thing about using a disc or a tiller, if we have to, is we're not trying to till the soil very deep. We're just trying to scratch the top of the surface just enough to cover up some of those larger seeds. Most of the other seeds that we grow will go on and sprout if we just broadcast them on the ground, as long as we have enough moisture when we're trying to grow them. So my strategy, if I have to use the disc or a tiller, is to broadcast the seed and then to make a single light pass where the tiller is just tilling in about an inch or so deep, or to do it with the disc. Sometimes that'll work as well. The principle of soil health that we run up against tends to be minimal soil disturbance. It's not called no soil disturbance, it's called minimal soil disturbance. And what we've found is that by minimizing, not completely eliminating soil disturbance, but by minimizing the soil disturbance with a disc or with a tiller or with our pigs, we can still improve the soil so very much without having to have the specialized equipment that cost a lot of money and is just not worth it for us to use at this stage of our lives. So tell me, what do you use to improve the soil health on your farm or in your garden or your soil? Have you tried using cover crops? If so, which ones did you use? Do you use livestock to help improve your soil, even if it's just nothing more than using the manure from a local horse barn and putting it out in your garden. Let me know what you do. So the first paddock that I put the pigs in on the southern end of Field B already has some Austrian winter peas, forage rape, and clover and ryegrass growing in it. I hope that we'll be able to put the pigs in there in 6 or 8 weeks. The second paddock should be ready to graze about three or four weeks after that. And then finally, the third paddock that the pigs are in now, I'm not sure. We're gonna have to wait and see what it looks like when I move the pigs off of that paddock. So my plan after we feed the current cover crops that we're planting now to the pigs, I hope that by the 1st of April or mid-April, I can go on and when the pigs graze it and move off of it, that I can plant buckwheat in it. Buckwheat is a great cover crop. I may put a forage rape in there too. But the thing that I like about buckwheat is it grows fast, it makes phosphorus available, it's good for the beneficial insects, and most importantly, in 60 days, it can have grain that the pigs can eat again. So that's a really good crop to plant. And then after the pigs eat that cover crop of buckwheat, I can plant my warm season cover crop mix that's really the powerhouse for increasing soil health out here. Again, plans change and you never really know what is going to play out. But the thing that I like about the five principles of soil health is that they help guide the decisions that they make. They're not hard, fast rules. Sometimes those things are in competition with one another. For example, if we let the pigs graze this and move off, there wouldn't be much of a living root in here. But by leaving them in there a little bit longer to disturb the soil a little bit more, we were able to put not only a single cover crop species in here to have a living root, but more cover crops in here, and there's no bare soil as well. And there's bare soil in here for a much more limited amount of time. Within 2 weeks or so, we'll have sprouting cover crop seeds. For me, does the payoff in having the pigs in here a little bit more, or doing a light pass with a disc behind my tractor, does that pay bigger dividends, not financially, but in terms of soil health in the long run? And many times that answer is yes. So stay tuned for our next videos for more updates on this journey to create much better soil in this 10-acre pasture over the next growing season, but also over the next several years. Until next time, it's Rob from Dowdle Family Farms wishing you the best. Take care. Have a great day.